bästa, krokodilen. Klockan 20 får vi bekanta oss med denna utrotningshotade art i Mitt i naturen film. Bara Spice Girls sålde fler skivor förra året. För John Fogerty blev det en dundersuccé efter comebacken efter 20 år. Och särskilt här i Sverige. Vi ska nu få se och höra John Fogerty berätta om sin musik och den pågående världsturnén i en intervju gjord av Bobo Eriksen.
I am truly very happy to be having a life in music. There's things that you have no way of knowing, but like my personal, my day every day involves a lot of guitar practice every single day. I love it. I'm obsessed with the guitar. And it's allowing me, let's say, to become what I always pictured I would become when I was a little kid. I thought I would grow up and be really good. And then I kind of grew up and I wasn't that good. But the last few years I've been working very hard at it, and now I'm starting to realize artistically things that I, let's say, had in mind many, many years ago. So there's a fulfillment to that. There's a joy, you know, and I get to show off. I mean, I know soon there will be a tour. I get to come and play in front of people and say, look what I've been working on, and there's sort of an instant release of that effort. I got a feeling way down inside. I can't shake it no matter how I try. You can't touch it, you just know the earth is gonna shake.
Where did you get the idea to do a live album? Was it because of the Blue Moon Swamp tour, or, I mean?
Well, actually, I myself have always wanted to do an album like this. Anytime I would think about it, I figured it's probably gonna be a live record. So that I could sort of have things from throughout my whole career on there. To me, it's like a trapeze artist working without a net. It brings a little extra edge to your performance. Ooh, you know, if you're gonna fall, you're gonna fall. And sometimes that makes you even better, makes you try even a little harder, which I think is what happened here. I mean, I'm pretty particular. I'm pretty reserved when it comes to what I allow to be released from myself. And I'm really happy with this. I think it's good performances, and the sound quality is very good. It sounds really good.
...1997 gav John Fogerty ut albumet Blue Moon Swamp efter en 10 år lång musikalisk tystnad. Skivan blev en enorm framgång såväl kreativt som kommersiellt. Den belönades med Grammy för bästa rockalbum i USA, och kritikerna världen över var överens om att det var det bästa han gjort som soloartist. Fansen tyckte samma sak. I Sverige var Spice Girls den enda utländska artist som sålde mer skivor än Fogerty under förra året. Turnén som följde var också succéartad, och livepubliken världen över jublade när John Fogerty för första gången på 3 decennier sjöng de bästa låtarna från hans år med Creedence Clearwater Revival. Det är den turnén som nu kommer ut som livealbum. Och låtar som Down on the Corner, Who'll Stop the Rain och Fortunate Son låter lika bra som de gjorde för 26 år sedan. För så länge sedan är det sedan superbandet Creedence Clearwater Revival splittrades. Och så många är åren som John Fogerty legat i juridiska tvister med sitt gamla skivbolag Fantasy Records och sina gamla bandkollegor.
when you're in a band, you're sort of stuck with, you have to settle for the abilities of the people that are in the band with you, for better or for worse. Creedence, or the guys in Creedence, had been together a long time, all through high school. We had been together about 9 years by the time we did Susie Q. Sometimes during that whole time, sometimes we were fairly serious, but a lot of the time it was very casual. I mean, where we maybe didn't even play together for a whole year. And so the idea that it was a group existed in my mind much more than in anybody else's. You know, they were off at college for a few years. My brother Tom had a day job and was married. I mean, the only person for much of that time that thought of it as a group was me. And even though I would go off and play with other people in other little, ensembles or combos, I always thought of my main group as being the people that you know as Creedence Clearwater. But when you have an organization, a group like that, if you are not musically the greatest in the world, which we weren't, you hope to find what are your strengths, and you hope to also identify what are your weaknesses and don't show anybody your weaknesses. I mean, I think that was my job. That's what I did. And I even made two or three speeches to the other guys that sounded very much like what I just said, meaning I remember saying, let's show them our strengths, let's do what we do very well in front of people, and let's don't do our weaknesses. Don't let them see what we don't do very well. One of the things we didn't do very well was play a shuffle beat. We are not the only middle-class white band in America that didn't play shuffle beat very well. That was kind of a common illness. The black guys from Texas could play shuffle, 24 hours a day, but in this country, a lot of the white bands ended up sounding like surf bands when they tried to shuffle. But we, in Creedence, we learned how to play a simple thing very strongly together. I think that was our biggest strength. We could play a groove. Nothing real complicated, nothing real far out like the Mahavishnu Orchestra or something. But simple, basic rock and roll, which is what I like anyway, we could do very well.
What about the life during those years as one of the biggest rock bands in history? Was it a rock and roll life, or was it a hard-working musician's life?
I don't think we were ever, let's say, in the league of Led Zeppelin. How can I say it? Everybody in the band had their moments now and then. I succumbed to the temptations of the road sooner or later, just like everybody else did. I think in my own case, though, I hate to say it, but I was more like Donny Osmond, or at least your image of Donny Osmond, than I was like John Bonham, let's say, or Keith Moon. Which is neither right nor wrong. It's just I happen to be sort of a shy.
They regard you as a commercial group.
I don't know. Shy and kind of scared person. The other guys in Creedence were a little bit more, shall I say, experimental. Maybe even reckless sometimes. But I mean, that was the time, you know. I don't really find, I don't find a big fault with that, not really, especially seeing that everybody of that same generation and of that same age, let's say, let me put it another way. I was real worried about all the casualties during those days, and I really had a strong sense of survival. I didn't want to end up being a casualty. That's probably what was my main motive in those days. I wanted to survive. All the music that I had created and had allowed others to pretend that they had something to do with it, it had gotten so diluted, especially by the time Creedence was a trio, that I could no longer supply my best work into something that was going to abuse it like that. It had become a dead end. I mean, there was no place out honorably for me except to leave, which I finally did.
That time, those years with Creedence stayed with you in a very negative sense up until what, 83? Because you were stuck in a contract.
Right.
Okay.
The only one that was stuck. That's what's aggravating, and that's the part people ought to know and don't really know. Fantasy Records held on to John Fogerty, but they let the other three members of Creedence go immediately. And yet, not one of the other three guys ever spoke up or said anything, you know, about how outrageous that was. And in fact, eventually, all three guys ended up helping Fantasy against me, to the extent that I think Stu Cook finally went down at some point after Center Field came out and played for Saul the record Old Man Down the Road, and Stu told Saul, you should sue John because he's sounding like Creedence. Well, if you think about it, John was sounding like John, perhaps, because John was the one who supplied those other songs to Creedence. But it was pretty outrageous that Stu would, how can I say it, he would betray John and side with Saul against John. I found that pretty outrageous. 737 coming out of the sky. Oh, won't you take me down to Memphis on a midnight ride? I wanna move. Hey, I need a traveling mind. Yeah. Well, I'm flying across the land, trying to get a hand. Hey, I need a traveling mind. Get me to the hotel, back it don't know well. Come on, come on, won't you get me to the room? I wanna move. Hey, I need a traveling mind.
when you think back about those years around the turn of the decade, 60s to 70s, is it a, you know, is it a happy feeling, a good feeling, or is it an anxiety and, you know?
I'm happy about the music that I was going to say we created. I'm certainly happy about the music I created, because that's still with me. You know, after living with an awful lot of pain and frustration and depression for many, many years, I am once again connected with the same self that created Born on the Bayou or the arrangement for Susie Q. I mean, all these things came out of my mind. And I'm very happy now when I look back on those things. How can I say it? I'm happier about my arrangement of Proud Mary than I am about some of the things I did on Eye of the Zombie or on almost anything I did on Mardi Gras. You know, I mean, these things can be at any time in your life. You can be doing good or not so good. But when I think about the circumstances under which a lot of the music was created, either my relationship with the other guys in Creedence or particularly the very bad relationship with Fantasy Records, I'm not very happy about that. I was just thinking the other day, you know, here's one guy way back then that was writing all these songs and singing these songs and had a very clear vision of what the music ought to sound like and what it took to make it sound that way. And just about everybody he met and has known from those times has turned in to be a creep. You know, I mean, that's kind of depressing, but everybody got very greedy, selfish, and full of ego. And that's kind of sad.
Well, if you want to ease your mind, you just go on. Take it to the river when you're down. But that's all right, you just bring it down to Jelly Roll. We're gonna rock, jump and shout. We're gonna slide way back.
You look so happy on stage. You look like a kid, you know. Just happy.
Thanks.
About being there. Is that so?
Oh, yeah, very much so. Well, you met my wife. Julie, I think everybody who's followed me at all knows that she has made me very happy. And in just in life in general and also about my music. Things have happened that I never thought would happen. Especially musically, you know, stuff that held me back for a long time is starting to be changed. And those things that I can't change, I'm starting to worry about a lot less. And here's another way to say the same thing. I'm concentrating on positive things now. And one thing that's very positive is playing my music in front of people, which I used to be, let's say, so sad or so blocked up in my heart that I just somehow I couldn't get out the door and get on a stage in front of people. And now I've found the means to do that. It's almost as if now that I'm finally there and that the audience has seen me and has found me, I don't have to go back to that other dungeon anymore. That's for those other people. And if they want to live there, that's fine, but I don't.
Well, if
who are still the most influence on me now was Chet Atkins and James Burton. But they were both so good, I couldn't imagine ever being that good. They were then, let's say, the star, the light that showed what was possible. But at the age of 9 or 10, I couldn't even imagine I would ever be that good. And I wasn't for a long, long, long time. But in the last few years, I've started to, let's say, imagine that someday I could be like Chet Atkins or James Burton. Now, they have a 35-year head start on me, so I may never catch up. You know, I say, hey, wait for me. But at least I'm enjoying the effort of, you know, now I can kind of play things that sound like Chet Atkins, at least. I mean, he's very technically very complicated. But it's fun to try. I mean, I've put a lot of work into it.
But about the old songs, I mean, could you say that you today play, all those songs from the early days, that you play them with a happy face, that you feel good about, you know, performing them?
Yeah, let's say a song like Born on the Bayou. I mean, to me, that is a wonderful rockin' song. It's not like something from, let's say, that's stuck in a time, like disco music, you know, and if you start singing the song, you almost have to have the boots and the afro hair and the polyester shirt and everything. Hey, baby, what sign are you? It's from a certain time. Whereas most of the songs I wrote, I think, are not stuck in a time because they're rock and roll. I really love rock and roll, which means, to me, you could get up anytime if you're playing with a rock and roll band and you can sing Fortunate Son and it still sounds rockin'. It doesn't have to sound like some corny old man, I don't know how to say it, just going through the motions, you know what I mean?
Some folks are born made to wave the flag, cool their red, white, and blue. And when the band plays Hail to the Chief,
I've always wanted to have a typical American boat, a big old Cadillac convertible with 6 guns for the whole, you know, for the door handles, and maybe silver dollars in the upholstery, and on the front one of those big the cow horns, you know, a cowboy car, and not shiny and brand new, a little bit kind of like a faded old cowboy. I've never had that, but I've always wanted to have that, and I could be driving down a big, long highway in the desert, and the sun would be going down, and the tumbleweed would be blowing across, you know, the highway, and I could, I mean, and a little shooting star up in the purple sky falling down, and the coyotes over here.
It sounds like a good video, actually.
Yeah,
Maybe you should make a video for the next album.
Well,
like
I know
that.
What car I'm getting.
There's going to be a new John Fogerty album with all new songs.
I hope next year.
Not another 10 years?
Not 98, but 99. Yeah, I'm writing songs now. I mean, that's not a promise. It's not a guarantee. It's just what I want to do. I want to just keep making music now. I think what I'm trying to say is, all those problems from the past that were such a blockade to me, even if they are not resolved, which some of those problems are not solved, and some of those things will never change, I'm not going to let them be in the way anymore. It's, why should I be looking over here at something as sad and stupid when I can look over here at something that's happy and optimistic? And that's what I'm doing. I'm looking at future, at joy, at a life in music, and I'm very excited about playing and being in front of people and making new songs.
Say bye.